And, you know, if we spent this time and you all just started typing in the things that God has done for you, we would spend a great deal of our time today and tomorrow and probably in through the week and beyond just listening to the incredible things that God has done for us. What a marvelous and wonderful God we have, that we might serve Him. I think of yesterday, and I have been surprised that I got some good responses back, you know, even off of line about the service and the message and all of that, with all of the technical problems that we had. And believe me, they were immense. None of us, except for perhaps Sherry and Josh, know just how bad they were, because they were trying to straighten them out through much of the service. But hopefully we'll have all of that straightened out by next Sunday. Pray for Josh, if you will, because he is he has training. He's teaching all week. He's the training instructor for Providence for security. And he's training all week, so he's got all of that on him, and he'll be coming home at night and trying to figure out the problem that we had with the camera and the setup and the hookup and exactly what we need to do. I got a feeling we're at that point. We're going to have to do some upgrading because things do change, and we've been using this system now for 3 years, so please be in prayer for him, because this is a real burden on him. He feels a real responsibility to the ministry to keep this thing as professional, as good as we can. And yesterday just didn't work out the way that we thought it should. But God blessed anyway. And, you know, I'm not one to get, I figure whatever happens and comes our way, God's in control and charge, so it doesn't take me to wringing my hands and pacing the floor and worrying about it. I trust God, and He always proves to be faithful. At any rate, a couple of things as we get ready to get launched in this morning. I got a text message from Terry. She did some calling after service yesterday, talked to some people who were missing and weren't there, and she found out, and the lady is up there this morning. Miss Ruth hurt her back last Wednesday. I hope and pray you are feeling better this morning, but put Ruth on your prayer list, if you will. She injured herself, and also, apparently, LeMay fell going out to the mailbox, fell in her driveway last week, and has hurt herself, and I'll be touching base as well. But put LeMay on your prayer list as well, if you will. Tanya as well. Kirk may have mentioned to those of you who are in Bible study, Tanya had, it's kind of a funny kind of seizure that she has. The whole body just spasms, and arms will flay in one direction, legs will, and it's a horrible thing to watch. And she had a couple episodes this summer, and she had one that lasted most of the night on Saturday night. That's why Kirk was home with her. Pretty exhausted by the end of that run, so appreciate you keeping her prayers. It's probably due to the new lesions that have been discovered on her spine, up close to the brainstem. So please continue to keep her in her prayers, if you would. I want to give a shout out, Carolyn. Good morning to you. It was so good to see you yesterday, and just good morning. And Miss Lena, it is really sweet to get to know you and have you there. God bless. Miss Sherry's there. Good morning, dear brothers and sisters. There's Miss Ruth. We love you, kiddo. Terry, thank you so much for keeping me informed and reaching out to some folks. We love you too, kiddo. Miss Donna, good morning to all my friends. Rick, God bless you. Good to see you. And Linda, and probably your sister-in-law here is out there as well. So we'll give Teresa a shout out and a hi this morning or two. Miss Sue, good morning to you. And Miss Alyssa, good morning with your three fine Baileys that are sitting around the table with you. We want to say hello to the three C's, Corey, Kara, and Cam. Good morning to each of you. And as we get ready to get started, I'm going to do a real quick overview here in a moment to bring us up to speed, because this is Monday and we had a lot that we covered as we went into chapter 3 last week, all right? So let's go ahead and have a word of prayer. Father, I want to thank you so very much for bringing us together this morning. And Lord, I thank you for Terry, and thank you, Lord, that she has brought to our attention Ruth has hurt herself, hurt her back. We lift Ruth up. Pray, Lord, that you will take the pain away, heal the injury, along with LeMay, Lord, having fallen, probably slipped on some ice or whatever, but fell there in a driveway. Lord, I pray that you will ease the pain that she's probably in, the bruising and all of that. Keep her safe, Lord, and bring her around, recuperate her, Lord. And I think of Cindy and Betty, and they're still in lockdown. They're in their facility, and Cindy has COVID. So we just pray, Lord, that you will comfort her and help her to get well. Thank you that it's not as severe and serious as it was in the beginning. But, Lord, it is still, you know, really prolific and easy to catch. So we just pray for your healing, your hand upon each and every one of them. God, you are still the God who heals the body, who refreshes the soul, who gives rest to the weary-hearted. So we come. And I pray, Lord, as we come, we find our rest significantly and totally, completely in you, that we would lean back and Lord, put every ounce of trust that we have, leaning not, as Solomon would say, on our own understanding, but trusting our ways into your hands. And, Lord, knowing that you will make our path straight and clear. God, we love you. We pray that you bring us into your word today. Open our hearts and minds to understand what you have for us. And Lord, I just pray that we catch a hold of the vision and catch a hold of the deep teaching within your word, that we give it the place in our heart and life that it so certainly deserves. To you we praise and honor and glory now, Lord, in Jesus' name, amen. Well, as we launched in last week, we moved into chapter 3, where we continued to look at the issue surrounding the law of the Sabbath. Remember, in chapter 2, this issue came up because the disciples were stripping off heads of grain and eating them and were accused of breaking the Sabbath law, to which Jesus responded with the account of David and his men eating the bread of witness. And then he continued with these words, and I've asked you to mark them down and even to memorize them, because I think they are a key for us perhaps each day as we learn to rest in Christ, who is our Sabbath rest. In 2 and verse 27, it says, Jesus said to them, "The Sabbath was made for man, and not man the Sabbath. So the Son of Man is Lord even of the Sabbath." That term, Son of Man, is a direct term relating Jesus to the Messiah. He's saying to everybody who had ears to hear, and many did, and enraged them when they would hear it, because the Son of Man is a name Daniel, in his prophecy, gives to the one who comes and stands before the Ancient of Days, the Messiah. So he's clearly saying that the Messiah is the Lord even of the Sabbath. And of course he is that Messiah, and that's what he's saying. Sherry and I have been watching the guy that cuts my hair, turned me on to a great Christian guy, really neat Christian guy, Christian musician, but just really a great guy. Asked if I had ever seen The Chosen, and I had not, not even really heard anything about it, maybe in passing, but he recommended it. So I went out and watched season 1 and season 2, found it on Amazon. I forget what medium it came through, but we found it on Amazon and watched season 1 and season 2. It was like we were watching it on TV as I was teaching some of these things. It's taken out of the book of Luke, but it's just been a great series to watch. And I'd recommend, if you want really to see some of this that we're talking about come alive in Technicolor, watch The Chosen. It's been very, very good. just, it's blessed. We're in season three, kind of not stream. Well, we are streaming it. We're watching it day by day. Didn't want to rush through it. But, you know, we have this encounter, these kinds of encounters. The emphasis, of course, turned to Christ as our Sabbath rest. Then we came to that Sabbath day encounter where Jesus heals the man with the withered hand. And that's in verses 1 through 6, and take a look at those again. He entered again into the synagogue, and the man who was there with a withered hand. And they were watching him, and this is one of the scenes that are also played out in The Chosen. Watching him to see that if he would heal on the Sabbath so that they might accuse him. And he said to the man with the withered hand, "Get up and come forward." And he said to them, "Is it lawful to do good or do harm on the Sabbath, to save a life or to kill?" But they kept silent. And you remember, we went into Matthew, and Matthew talks about the Sabbath relief, where if you have a sheep that falls in the mud, then on the Sabbath, you don't let him, you know, suffer in the mud. You go ahead and pull him out. That's called Sabbath relief. And 200 years earlier, of course, they were able to say, yes, it's okay to fight and preserve life on the Sabbath during the Maccabean revolt. But at any rate, after he kept looking around at them with anger, grieved with the hardness of their heart, he said to the man, "Stretch out your hand." And he stretched it out, and the hand was restored. And the Pharisees went out and immediately began conspiring with Herodians against him as to how they might destroy him. Now, this whole encounter shows us this growing hatred of the Pharisees for Jesus. Their attempt to trap him so that they might accuse him blew up in their faces, because Jesus used their own laws and regulations, even their man-made rules that they put around, to justify the healing of this man. And certainly, Jesus is saying this man's more valuable than any animal. So to relieve his suffering would certainly come under the regulations of Sabbath relief, as prescribed by those elders some 200 years earlier. And of course, Jesus doesn't even raise a hand. He just simply commands the man to stretch out his hand. Doesn't touch him, does absolutely no work at all, just speaks to him. Which really becomes evident that it was God that was working to heal the man's hand on the Sabbath. The only work that was done by God. The only effort that was given was the man as he reached out and stretched out his hand. So technically, they couldn't even bring that accusation that he did anything, didn't lay hands on him, nothing. Now, two things happened next. The Pharisees went immediately and began to conspire with the Herodians, which they hated. And second, Jesus' popularity began to spread, and thousands upon thousands came from all over just simply to see him. Remember this, and this is kind of the graphic I gave you that shows how far and wide these people were coming. And Jesus withdrew to the sea with his disciples, and a great multitude from Galilee followed, and also from Judea, there to the south, and Jerusalem, even further, you know, about central in south, and from Idumea, which is beyond the Jordan, in the vicinity of Tyre and Sidon. A great multitude heard all that he was doing, and they came to him, all the way up into Lebanon and into Syria and down almost to Egypt, out into the Arabian Desert, you know, way, way south of the last, you know, dark-colored area that you see there. That's the region that people were coming. You see, it amazes me when you look at that map and you think about they didn't have technology. They didn't have the internet, Facebook, YouTube. They didn't have computers. They couldn't broadcast all of this. Didn't have radio or television or telephone. They had simply the word of mouth. Remember, the gospel spread to the very ends of the earth by word of mouth. Not by the internet or anything else. We think, you know, I enjoy the technology. Don't get me wrong. I really do. And if this thing comes off next Saturday and I am truly able to preach and to teach all the way to the, you know, to Grace Baptist Church in Mindanao, then, you know, that is to me a miracle. It's a wonder that God has allowed. But you see, it's still the same thing. You communicate one mouth to another. one starving man telling another starving man where they can find. And that's exactly what you have here. You have people saying, hey, this guy, you know, healed my friend, and he can do the same for you. It's the idea that this man saved me from my sin, saved me from myself, and he can do the same for you. Problem with this multitude, though, is that they were more interested in what Jesus could do for them than the message that he came to share. Jesus, if you remember, says in Mark chapter 1, verses 14 and 15, that he came into Galilee preaching the gospel of God and saying, the time is fulfilled and the kingdom of God is at hand. Repent and believe in the gospel. The miracles were there simply to authenticate the message and not the other way around. But for the people, they had a consumer mentality. They were sign seekers, if you will. They were ones that came because they were hurting and they were in need, and they were coming to a man because they'd heard he could do something for them. Now, I understand the importance of that. You see, when we begin to realize our need, we fled to Jesus because of what he can do for us. He can save us from our sin. But you see, they weren't coming to hear the message of salvation. They weren't coming, you know, and maybe that is the way it is with a lot of people. They first come because they have this great need, but then they hear the great gospel message and their life is turned around. But for many of these people, it just simply had to do with, could he relieve my suffering? Some came, certainly, out of curiosity. They're hearing that he's the Messiah. Well, is he? And we know that the Pharisees, the scribes, the priests, you know, they were coming, you know, to trap him. So you got this incredible crowd of people, some with pure motives, some with self-seeking motives, and some with not so pure motives. But the crowds are growing. You see, when God reveals himself, and this was the key lesson that I gave you last week, when God reveals himself, we either choose to acknowledge him and surrender, or we ignore him, we suppress the truth, and as Paul says, in unrighteousness, we become harder and harder and harder because God just simply removes that which restrains us and turns us over to our sin. That's a dangerous, dangerous position to be in. It moves us into the next section in chapter 3, which is the calling of the 12. This is the first time in Mark's gospel that we find that they're all gathered now. He's got them together. Let's take a look at verses 13 through 19. It says, he went up on the mountain and summoned those whom he himself wanted. And they came to him, and he appointed 12 so that they would be with him, and he could send them out to preach and to have authority to cast out demons. And he appointed the 12, Simon, to whom he gave the name Peter, and James, the son of Zebedee, and his brother, or John, James, the son of Zebedee, and John, the brother of James. To them he gave the names Boanerges, which means sons of thunder. Verse 18, and Andrew, and Philip, and Bartholomew, and Matthew, and Thomas, and James, the son of Alphaeus, or James the Lesser, and Thaddeus, and Simon the Zealot, and Judas Iscariot, who, it says, betrayed him. Now, we're going to piece this out, piece by piece by piece. There we go. Verse 13 says, and he went up on the mountain and summoned those whom he himself wanted, and they came to him. Now, the primary method of Jesus' ministry was going to be through these 12 men. He sets a precedent. Jesus knows he can't be everywhere at all times in every place, so he sets a pattern. The pattern of developing and discipling a certain group of people who would then go out and multiply his teaching and his activity all over the region, all over the area. Ultimately, that same group, minus one, and then added in some others, would be going out into the whole world doing the very same thing and building. And it is from this infant building block that the worldwide global mission of Christ begins. The first thing we saw him doing following his baptism and temptation was just to call a few men to follow him. And we know the initial four was Simon and Andrew, those two brothers, Peter and Andrew. and James and John. Matthew was the next to be called, Levi. So we have five. And now there will be a total of 12. Notice first the sovereign desire of the Lord. Here it says that he summoned those whom he himself wanted. Jesus called those whom he desired. This is the election of God. It is the manifestation of the greatness of God. On that basis, he calls us. On the basis of his desire. Listen, when you came to Christ, it's because he desired you. He put his loving grace and mercy to begin to draw you to himself. No man comes unto the Father, John says, Jesus says through John, in John's gospel, unless the Spirit of him who sent me draw him. That word means to woo, to love to romance. So he wooed us to himself. Now, sometimes that wooing was a little difficult, because with that comes the conviction of sin and the knowledge of our own need and our own sufficiency and a turning of our heart and life to him who becomes our sufficiency. But you see, I believe that one of the greatest miracles that we find is as God draws us and we come into that loving, saving relationship with him. Because literally, we are raised from the dead. We come from the kingdom of darkness and death into the kingdom of light and life. We are made children of God. Where we were children of our father, the devil, we are now children of God. We were in Adam, and now we are in Christ. I think that's a miracle in itself, don't you? And aren't you pleased and glad of that miracle? Debbie, I didn't hear you pop in there, but I see you there. God bless you, sister. It's good to see you. What a great time, and what a great conversation we had yesterday. God bless you. All right? That God would desire me is such an incredible thought. Oh, what is there in me that God would set his desire for me? But he did. He saw in me what I could never see in myself, and I will be forever grateful. That the all-holy God, who is pure, who is of purer eyes than could look upon iniquity, would desire the fellowship of creatures whose very natures are twisted and tormented by sin. It's pure. Pure. What's that word? Good morning, Teresa. Give you a shout out. What's that word? What's the word that would take a God whose eyes are pure that could behold sin, and he would draw those creatures twisted by sin to himself? Well, I won't make you type it up there. You can if you want to. You all know the word. Starts with a G and ends with an E. Grace. It's all of grace. Not by my work or my ability or my personality, but by the grace of God. Yes, Carolyn, grace in capital letters. Jesus's choice of disciples would probably not be ours, would it? When you consider that group of people, what a motley group of followers. You have four blue-collar fishermen, one hated, despised tax collector, one doubter, one member of an underground army called the Zealots, and one betrayer. And there's a lot that we don't know about some of the others. We know more about some than we do others, and we'll discuss that a bit later. We know virtually nothing about six of these men whose names never appear again in Mark's gospel. Verse 14 says, he appointed 12, so what? That they could be with him. You want to underscore that? Why did Jesus call you to himself? Why did he save you? Why did he make you a child of God? Why did he pick you up out of the desperate pit of sin, out of the slough of despond, as Pilgrim's Progress would put it? Why did he do that? Why did he pick you out, clean you up, and make you his? underline this, so that they would be with him. You would be with him. He desires that intimate, personal attachment, that connectedness between you and him, and that he might send them out to preach. Twofold reason: be with him and do what he does, and to have authority to cast out demons. You say, do I have that authority? Well, we'll cover that. Little different then, I think, than it is now. Oh, do I think demons can be cast out? Absolutely. But do I have the same power and authority that a Peter or Paul do, who are directly anointed by God for the ministry of an apostleship that is different than the apostleship that we would see play out today? Yeah, big difference. Please notice why Jesus called them. We often look at this as a call to preach and to take authority over demons, but that's not why he called them. That's why the text says, so they would be with him. It's really, really important that we understand that the essence of Christianity is simply to be with Jesus. It means to dwell in his presence. It is a relationship with him. Never miss that point. We get all caught up in some of the spectacular things that happen, but the first thing he says about this, you know, beyond all the other spectacular things, is that they would be with him. Oftentimes we think that it's to go out and do something, but the essence of Christianity is simply to be in Christ, with him. You see, that's the radical nature of the message. How can sinful people dwell in the presence of a holy God? It is through, in and by, Jesus Christ, our Savior and our Lord. It is through Jesus, his person, his work, that sinners can dwell in the presence of a holy God. We can be with Jesus. When Jesus called the 12 that they might be with him, he called them to share his life. That's what this is all about. When he called them to make disciples, they were to multiply the very life of Christ that was in them in others. And like the loving master he is, he wanted them involved in the intimate communication and fellowship with him. And he called them to be in relationship with him before he ever sent them out two by two to carry the gospel, to heal the sick, to bind up the brokenhearted and the wounded, and yes, even to deliver people from demonic possession. He desired them to share their lives with one another and with him. Now we see the intimacy of community. That's what the church is all about, is it not? You know, we are one body sharing in intimate communion with one another. Is that not what it is? We are connected and attached. I look at this list of people out here and the 100 more that are out that aren't signing in, and you know, all over, you know, here we're plugged into places all over the world. We are one body in Christ. And when you come down to our little neck of the woods, to our Church Hall Boulevard, we are one body together. That's what we are. He knew the only way this was going to be accomplished was to impart his life to these men. He was going to reproduce himself in them, that he had to impart his life. And in order to do that, there had to be time spent together. That's why it's so important that we get together and come together. Because in that is that we're literally, you know, having him, allowing him to impart some of himself, his life to us, that we might learn and grow and then take that out, certainly. We can't miss that part of it. He called them to be with him, but to go out, you know, and carry him out to the world. The only way life can be imparted is to spend time sharing that life. Am I not right? And this is how Christianity is to work. His people are to share their lives with others. Why? Because he shared his life with us. We who are following Christ are to seek to reproduce ourselves in the lives of others. To take what God has given to me and to give to you, if I were to just keep it to me, I'd be the worst of the worst of the worst. Whatever God shares with me, I'm under obligation to him and you to share it with you. And if you receive it as a word from him, and it becomes the engrafted and planted word of God in your life, you're under obligation to him and to others to share it with them. Notice what Paul said to the Corinthian church as he was sending Timothy to them in 1 Corinthians chapter 4, verses 14 through 16. I do not write these things to shame you, but to admonish you as my beloved children. For if you were to have countless tutors in Christ, yet you would not have many fathers. For in Christ Jesus, I became your father through the gospel. I exhort you, therefore, be imitators of me. Paul says, be imitators of me. Paul wanted them to follow Christ. So he encouraged them to imitate him because that's what he was doing. He was following Christ. You say, now that's kind of a braggadocious statement. No, it's not. It's a statement of fact. Paul is saying, I'm following Christ. If you want to follow Christ, you need an example. Come on, you know, imitate me because I'm imitating Christ. He goes on in chapter 11, verse 1 to say, be imitators of me, just all as also I am of Christ. That's exactly what he's saying. As I imitate Christ, if you need a physical example to look at, I'm imitating Christ, follow my example, imitate me. Paul wanted them to imitate him as he followed Christ, but he couldn't be with them, so he sent Timothy, who was an imitator of Paul. And that's the way it works. Look at this. In chapter 4, 1 Corinthians chapter 4, I exhort you, therefore, be imitators of me. Verse 17, for this reason I have sent to you Timothy, who is my beloved and faithful child in the Lord, and he will remind you of my ways which are in Christ, just as I teach everywhere in every church. Paul says, I can't be with you, but I got a young guy here, Timothy. I mean to tell you, he's with me, he's learned of me, he's following me, he's imitating what I do, he's an imitator of me as I imitate Christ. I can't be with you, so you know, I'm going to give you the very best next thing. I'm sending Timothy to you, who's going to be like Paul to you, like Jesus to you, because he's imitating me. Do you get the picture? Do you see this? I want you to imitate me, so I'm sending Timothy to you. Timothy was a reproduction of Paul. Paul says, pass on to faithful men who are able to pass on to faithful men, and on it goes. He passed it on to Timothy. He took what God gave him, he gave it to Timothy, he sent Timothy out, and Timothy gave it to them. They picked it up, and those who were disciples of Timothy went out and took what Timothy got from Paul, which Paul got from Jesus, and passed it on to others and down through the generations to you and to me. Paul couldn't be there. So he said Timothy was just like him, and this is the goal of Christianity, to reproduce the very life of Christ in others. That word in the Great Commission, when it says, go and make disciples of all nations, that imperative, make disciples, that word is the word we get multiplication from. We are to multiply the very life and ministry and message of Christ in the lives of others. The Bible teaches us that the elders, the pastors of the church, are to be examples to the flock. And I pray, I honestly do, I think every day I pray that I have been and will continue to be a good example. Where I've failed you, I apologize. My failing is not on Christ, it's on me. 1 Peter 5, verses 1 through 3. Peter writes this, the great fisherman, called first by Jesus. Therefore I exhort the elders among you, as your fellow elder and witness of the suffering of Christ, and a partaker also in the glory that is to be revealed, shepherd the flock of God among you, exercising oversight, not under compulsion, but voluntarily, according to the will of God, and not for sordid gain, but with eagerness, nor yet as lording it over those allotted to your charge, but proving to be examples to the flock. Church of God is to be led by the living visual power of example. We all need examples to follow, don't we? We have parents and grandparents, aunts, uncles. We also have example. They're all examples to our children and grandchildren. You know, from firsthand knowledge that you pick up what you do much quicker than what people say. I'm thinking right now, it crosses my mind. We got a holiday bread that we make called petits. My grandkids wanted to learn to make it. My son, daughters, all of them learn how to make a petits. The recipe was preserved by my wife. My mother received it from her mother-in-law. My grandmother didn't speak English. Mother didn't speak Slavic. So, you know, grandma never measured anything by cups. She always did it in her hand. She had big hands. So she took my mother, and she would take and she would scoop the flour and give it to my mother. My mother would measure it out in a cup and she would write it down. All of that, everything that went into it, you know, was taught by example. My grandmother could not speak English, taught by example, by making my mother do it and doing it right alongside her. And she didn't like my mom very much, but they did it because it's something Dad wanted. And Mother learned to make petitza. She passed it on to us. She taught my wife how to make it. She taught my daughter-in-law, my brother's wife. They didn't make it for a lot of years, but my wife preserved the recipe and we made it. And the way my wife has taught my kids and my grandkids to make the dough and make the bread and roll it out is by hands-on example, experience. That's the way it's passed on. That's the way Christ is passed on one to the other. The parent who says, do as I say, not as I do, is asking a child to overcome a very powerful, powerful example. And this is wrong. The child will imitate the parent's example. Well, I'm going to give you verse 14, and we'll pick up on verse 14 tomorrow. But it says that he appointed 12 that they might be with him and that he might send them out to preach. Be with him and do as he did. Well, I think it's about time that we wrap this up. The first priority we have is fellowship with Jesus. He called these early disciples to be with him. He desired fellowship with him. And they needed fellowship with him. They needed to learn of him before they could imitate him. No different today. Each day we come together, we need to learn of him. Some truth, some nugget that we can take in and make our own and then imitate. Father, I thank you for the overwhelming preciousness of your word. Thank you for the vivid, vivid examples that we have that can jump off a page and dance around in our minds, impact our hearts. God, as we close this morning, I just simply want to say thank you. Thank you that you desired me in, and those that are out here that are your children, you desire us, that we would simply be with you, first and foremost, to be with you. Oh, I know, Lord, being with you is precursor to imitating you and doing as you did But oh, that first point, that we could come today and just be with you. Thank you, Lord. And might we keep that in mind as we go about all the various activities of our day, that you called us today to be with you. And in that relationship and fellowship will come, certainly, doing as you did. Thank you, Lord. Fill us with anticipation for what you are going to do in our life today as we seek to serve you faithfully. In Jesus' name, amen. Don't forget to pray for those that need our prayer, Cindy and Betty, and those that are in the care center there. For Ruth as she heals up from hurting her back. For LeMay as she fell. Others that you might remember and know about, pray for them and keep them in your prayer. And we'll be back here tomorrow at 9. Reach out, pick up a phone, call somebody, or go see them. Let somebody express the love of Christ to somebody today. Don't let the sun go down before you do. Make it a determination of your will that this day, at some point today, I'm going to express verbally and in some way, physically to somebody, the very love of Christ. Let them know you love them. We know why. Because as John says, love is of God. We'll see you tomorrow, 9 o'clock. God bless.